How old are you now, Peter?
I am 60 in a few weeks.
Do you still consider yourself as a hippie?
I never considered myself as a hippie. I don't think anyone ever considered themselves as a hippie. Mm-hmm. It's what other people called you when they saw anyone with long hair or leading a slightly different sort of life.
In the southwest of Ireland, right in the middle of nowhere, is a very remote place where people of the modern world go to recharge their batteries. This hidden place is called Dzogchen, Beara, and it has now become one of the most important centres in the West where people go to prepare for death, but most of all, to find meaning in life. Sogyal Rinpoche, a Tibetan teacher, is the spiritual director of this retreat centre. He is the author of the worldwide bestseller, The Tibetan Book of Living and Dying. Since 1992, thousands of people have visited Dzogchen Beara for short or even very long-term retreats. More than 30 years ago, Peter Cornish, a guy with long hair and hardly any sight, moved into an old ruined farmhouse, the only trace of civilization around. In this magnificent windy place, he and his wife Harriet started living their dream. They felt that the world was in need of a new spiritual direction, and they wanted to create a place where people could find just that. Peter, with his very bad eyesight, started to build from scratch. Without an architect, without a builder, just with some inherited money and a little help from his friends. And now, after 30 years of building, he is finally doing what he has always wanted to do, living the life of a hermit and preparing himself for the most important thing.
Incredibly fortunate to somehow have wangled my way into this position. That's how I see it, honestly. I'm sure I have as much pride as anyone else in all kinds of different ways, but as far as what we've achieved here is, it just isn't a matter of pride. I don't know if I can explain that to you, but it's a way. When I first came here and I bought 150 acres of land, and people said to me, "Wow, how fantastic, you've got 150 acres of land. That must feel really good." And I didn't really understand what they meant, because always my feeling had been that you can't own land. I never felt I owned this land. You can't own those rocks and everything that you've seen out there. You can't own that. I mean, I was just, by some miracle, a caretaker of this for some short period in the history of this planet. And I just didn't have that sense of ownership at all.
I think if we go up to the top of these rocks here, we'll be able to sit down. So I'm just going to push the gorse down a bit for you here.
Yeah.
Because there's enormous holes going down, maybe even hundreds of feet, through the cliff here. And I'd really rather that none of us fell in one of those. I think it was just a matter of putting one foot before the other foot and just keeping going, you know. We just started very small. I remember when I first came here, I was suddenly confronted with the realization that I'd just bought 150 acres. And I thought, my God, that's so much land. Where am I going to start? I've got to fence it. There was going to be so much work to do. And I remember there were some steps behind the old ruined farmhouse over there. And for about the first two or three weeks, I was sitting there with a hammer and chisel just cutting these steps to make them a bit better, because it was the first thing nearest to me that I could do that was really simple, because I was completely mind blown by the thought of how much work I'd taken on. Remember, none of those buildings used to be there. None of them. Nothing that you can see was there. Yeah, I started with a round piece here, which I can't see where it is from here, but I'm pointing in that direction. I hope you can. Keep going. The centre was finished. We made it a charity. And I decided that I needed to find somewhere quiet to live for myself. So I came over here, dug a hole in the ground, which is now the conservatory, which is behind that red wall there, and started to build a little retreat hut in there. And it was all sort of underground and hidden. A friend, Ian Maxwell, came by one Christmas and said, "God, you can't live here and not have a view." So I thought, yeah, maybe he's right. I was more into sort of doing dark retreats and keeping underground at that point. And then I thought, yeah, he's right, for God's sake. So I had to put another story on it. So that's the bit, that's the round bit you see up there now. Yeah. Now I built up so there was a bit of a view. I was building it out of the rubble that came out of the hole that we dug. We dug a hole about the size of a tennis court, and then we put a roof over it. I used the stone to build with, and then when I'd run out of the stone, I used the rubble to mix with cement and make my own blocks for building. Mm-hmm. And I made those blocks in plastic kitchen basins, and did about, I had 40 plastic kitchen basins, and then I would each day smear engine oil all over them, and then mix this mix of cement and rubble from the hole there, mm-hmm. And fill those basins, and then turn out the previous day's blocks. So I was making 40 blocks a day, and then using those blocks to build with. We'll cobble all of this here eventually. That's the effect. There's the little blocks we make.
These are the lunch boxes.
These are lunch boxes. When my son was about 10 years old, he came over one day from the centre there to see me after school. And he was looking at this building. He hadn't been over for a few months, and he was looking at this building that I'd been building sort of higgledy-piggledy out of stones. And he was scratching his head and looking at it. And I said, "What are you thinking about, Tom?" And he said, "Well, Dad, how come you're building a ruin when everyone else is knocking them down?" It's just what happened was really that I was in the middle of doing that when I had this sort of picture of how the rest of the building should be, and I realised, this is not going to be my little retreat hut. It's got to be a lot bigger. Mm-hmm. And to make it, I decided I just had to do that.
Yeah.
So I started it. I had no money at all, not a penny at that time. In fact, I was in debt heavily to the bank. And but I decided I had to do it anyway, and I started building. And to do that, I had to use, realized I had to use fairly conventional means, mm-hmm. ordinary bought in blocks and so on. And then bit by bit, I built it, and the money just came in,
yeah.
from all kinds of unexpected places. Thank you. we rely on our eyes so much because that's, I suppose, our major sense. But actually, it's amazing how much you can do without such good sight. And a friend from Alahis was helping me, and it was getting dusk, and he was banging a 6-inch nail into a large piece of wood. And a couple of times I heard him curse because he hit his thumb. So I went inside and said, "Here, I'll do that for you." And he looked at me, "Oh yeah? Blind man gonna knock in the 6-inch nails when I can't do it?" And so I took the hammer and I hammered that 6-inch nail in perfectly without hitting my thumb once. Sometimes our eyes get in the way, you know. One good example, actually, if I wanted to get a level, I needed to make the walls level. So I've got the most perfect level here, look, the horizon, all the way across. So I would get my head down to the height of the wall and see if it was level with the horizon. Yeah. This was because, you know, the spirit level with a little glass, with a little bubble, air bubble in the spirit level. Of course, I couldn't see that. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of people might think, well, how do you build without a spirit level? That's how you build without a spirit level. My plan now is to do actually what I've been talking about for about 30 years, let's say, finally, which is to really seriously practice, to go into retreat and practice, hopefully, for the rest of my life, because I've done enough. I feel I've done enough. If I'm going to retire, I could spend the rest of my days in a comfortable little cottage, watching television, going down to the golf club, having a pint with the other old gentleman, getting steadily grumpier and grumpier. Or I could actually just go into my little place that I have there and just practice, keep quiet. It's quite an ecological way to behave, isn't it, after all? Don't consume much. Don't have a car, don't have television, don't go anywhere. It's very attractive to me, actually, but that's an aside, really. The real reason is that I wish to make some spiritual progress at this point. It is time that I got on with the job that I believe this life is all about, which is actually preparing for the most important part of this life, which is actually your death. So obviously, if you think that there are lives beyond this life, and that it is a process, that death is just a part then of an ongoing situation, obviously, within that context, death becomes all important, because it's a transition to the next life. And how you handle that death, it is said, how you handle that death is entirely relevant to how and where you get reborn in your next life. And so there are practices which are taught by Tibetan teachers of just how to handle that time of death. And if you become skilled in certain practices, even you can get out of this cycle of samsara, as we call it, at that moment of death. Oh, you just believe in rebirth, or there's more and more lives after this one. You believe that. That's what you like to think. And actually, I say to them, "You're kidding. It would be so much more comfortable to think that this was it, and there's nothing after this. My God, you could have real fun then." I think what is morbid, actually, is not thinking about death. I think that everyone obviously is conscious of death. It's all around us all of the time, particularly with this scourge of cancer now. I think
And then people repress it. And that's morbid. It just increases the fear of this unknown thing, which they don't admit, which they deny all the time. And actually, to think about death to look at it, to have eyeball-to-eyeball contact with death, if you like, to look it straight in the face and get on with it, it removes a lot of the fear for a start. Mm-hmm. And it's just a job you have to get on with. You really accept it. And I think the more that people think about it, without the paranoia, without the fear, the more that people think about it sensibly, rationally, easily, then the less morbid it is, actually. It's only the fear of death that's the morbid bit, isn't it? I've given away and got rid of nearly all of my physical possessions now.
Mm-hmm.
So all that's left to deal with is the mental possessions.
Yeah. How many are there left?
Oh, a few. 60 years, quite a few. Yeah. All those memories, dreams, unfulfilled dreams,
yeah.
Naughty things you did.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wouldn't necessarily say mistakes because I don't really believe in mistakes, but all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But for me, the way is not to go through all that and deal with them one by one. Actually, mm-hmm. the way to do it is through the practice that I hope to do, and all that stuff should just fall away. Living in London throughout the 60s and was very much involved with the scene that was happening in London. We really believed that the world needed to be changed and perhaps we could change it a little bit. And then by about 1968, things were getting a little bit out of hand. The whole thing had become totally commercialized, and most of my friends had said more or less to hell with this, and they'd dropped out and gone to find places to live in the country.
That's Harriet leading me on the first horse we had when we first came to Ireland, and we couldn't get a car in, so we had a horse and cart, and that's the horse.
First came here in 1973 from Scotland, and we were looking for a place to start a centre, and we'd looked all around the southernmost peninsula, and I'd had just a little two-liner from an estate agent saying 150 acres of rough coastal land near Castletown Bear. We nearly didn't come, but then we thought as we were in Castletown Bear we might as well have a look. Remembering this sort of picture, dream that I'd had when I was a child of a place where I wanted to establish a place, a community. I wasn't sure even whether it was a spiritual community or a community for artists, but a place for people to live. And this was a sheer mountainside with a terrace, and then a cluster of houses in the middle of the terrace, and a cliff below us, and then a vast plain with a little pile of hills in the distance. And this picture had been with me for years. And then as we came up to the top and turned the corner, there was this vast bowl of the Atlantic in front of us. And then the horizon, the sea started almost at our feet, and the horizon up very high, and the sky. And we just stood there, really dumbstruck.
I mean, neither of us spoke, and we just stood there. What I saw there was exactly this picture that I've had in my head for all those years. So immediately I thought, this is it. And Harriet and I, when we sort of came to, we just sort of ran down through the fields and we were laughing, and it was just so wonderful. My wife Harriet was very much moved by this thought that it was actually, we called at that time self-sufficiency, and it was the idea that perhaps we could become self-sufficient in some way, live slightly outside the established order, grow our own vegetables, keep our own animals, and not be totally dependent upon a society that we felt was going in the wrong direction.
That's where I used to milk the cows in there, and there's a little low window. Can you see a low window in that end of it? And I used to look through that window. That was almost at floor height, that window, right down near the ground. So I used to sit there milking the cow, gazing down the bay, all across the sea, and then to the hills, and the, and then thinking of another ocean beyond it and more hills. And then I used to think of London and Piccadilly Circus and all that stuff. Just to remind myself that there were other beings on this planet, because it really seemed as though there was no one in the rest of the universe apart from me at that time.
I had another reason, which was actually pursuing this path of establishing a Dharma center, a retreat center, a place for peace and meditation. And while perhaps the world, it was very valid that people should come and try and find a way to live outside the system and take care of their material needs in that way, I felt very strongly that the whole world had lost its spiritual direction as well. And it's actually only through sitting down and meditating and letting your conceptual mind fall away, really, I guess, that then the truth, you can personally experience the truth, and that's the only way you'll see the truth. And so the rest of it is, with your ordinary mind, you can become very learned, very scholarly, very clever, but wise.
I never look at these pictures. I hate it.
Why?
The past. It's all gone. No, I don't really, but I mean, it doesn't fill me with wonderfully romantic memories. It was pretty tough here. Some of it was okay. So there you are. There's a nice little one of Florental. Oh, no, it's not Florental. It's Flora and the Bridesmaids.
She died at the age of 44, yes, I mean, incredibly early, as far as I was concerned, which was in 1993. Mm-hmm. We'd just finished the centre over there, and we'd just made it a charity, and a few weeks before she died, she signed the deed of trust establishing the place as a charity, and I was very happy that she had at least seen that come to its conclusion. Mm-hmm. Of course, since then I've wished so much that she would have seen this place. Actually, she saw this conservatory. When just before she died, I got as far as building this conservatory, none of the rest of the building, but this was finished. And she actually came in here 3 days before she died. She walked up the cliff and looked around, and I'd finished planting. She hadn't been in here for about 6 months, and I'd got the roof on. And she looked around and said, "Now I see the point of it."
Harriet's death made me all the more determined to carry on, to complete the dream which she and I had shared. And when it was getting towards winter, and I had to face undoing her clothes cupboard, and then I was burning some of her old clothes and things, and around that time, of course, difficult. There was never actually a time of despair. I mean, it's difficult to describe it, the feeling of bereavement, feeling of loss, of sort of emptiness, but not of despair. And when I was feeling like that, sort of in the background all the time was brewing away the fact that I was really going to make it work for Harriet, you know? And I think in the material world, as the world has become more materialistic, then and we're clinging on to possessions, I suppose our most favoured possession is our own body, isn't it? And then would be the bodies of our loved ones. So to let go of those becomes increasingly difficult as we become more materialistic. And I suppose within any spiritual tradition, I guess, you learn not to be so grasping onto these things. I've noticed how, I think everybody's probably noticed, how after the absolute horror of what happened in Tibet, I mean, it was as bad as what was happening in Germany. And the Tibetans never talk about it. They never make a fuss about it. I've never heard the Tibetans complaining about it. Sometimes you can sort of screw some facts out of them, but they never actually moan about their lot at all. And they have this incredible ability to accept what's happened. And I think that actually grows in you on any spiritual path. You are able to accept things more easily. So whether that's the death of your wife or your own death or whatever. I was going to finish it after I had finished the rest of the building there. I was coming back to it. And about the time I was going to come back to it, then there was a lama who came here called Tuku Pegyal. And he was saying to me, "Peter, it's time to stop building." And then there was Chadlu Kandro who came here. And she said to me also, it's time you started practicing and stop building. They weren't telling me anything I didn't know. I just needed them to tell me, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
And did you really stop building now?
Yeah.
Honestly?
Yes and no. No, I have stopped building. I mean, there's a few little blocks that are appearing here and there, you know. Yeah. I'm making a little tiny place. 3 foot by 4 foot onto my retreat hut there, so I can sit and look out at the sky and the sea. And I mean, really, it is tiny, a box. Mm-hmm. A box with underfloor central heating in it. Mm-hmm. So I can sit there. It's got one large window, so I can sit there with the window open. I can keep warm and be quite comfortable. Mm-hmm. And I hope to spend a large part of the rest of my life in that box.
What is the attraction of being the rest of your life in a box?
Oh, yeah, well, that's... Well, yeah, it's always a bit of a shock to them. I'm sure to have to be in a box. Why not get in a box and practice before you die? I mean, the attraction is that's the best way to practice meditation. We'll be right back. Once I make my mind up about something, that's it. I made my mind up. I enter it wholeheartedly. And I think I have. I think that would be the same about what kept me going. That once I've had the idea and I have settled on it, it's difficult to turn me from my path because I just enter into it completely. It became my life, and there was never any question. There weren't any alternatives. So how I kept going was, actually, there was never any alternative. This was what I was going to do. Thank you.